And you know, we can just think about in planetary system and focus mostly in planetary systems, although I will talk a bit about triple stars. We can think about, of course, circumbinary planets, okay? So Tatooine. And of course, we can talk about moons, right? In our solar systems, a sun, a planet, and a moon is a triple system. And you can talk about, of course, triple stars, as mentioned. And even when you talk about binary planets, you can talk about a planet around one star, both of them orbiting the other star, or a planet orbiting both stars. So you have even you have different kind of planetary systems. And of course, you have just multiple planet systems. And we know that actually a huge fraction of all the planetary systems, the exoplanet systems that we see, are actually multiple planets with at least two planets, which means there are triple or higher multiplicity. So effectively, when we talk about exoplanet systems, we almost always talk about some kind of triple or higher multiplicity systems. So the dynamics of triple is extremely important in order to understand the evolution and also the formation of exoplanet systems. So what are we talking about when we talk about triple systems? So we always talk about kind of an inner binary orbited by a third companion outer orbit. So you have an inner binary. Let's say, again, we have, for example, the a star, a planet, and another star, okay? So in this case, we have the inner orbit is M1 and M2, and we have the third companion, which is M3. And the outer orbit would have its orbital parameters, the same major axis, eccentricity, inclination, and other orbital parameters, of course. And the same thing is true for the inner orbit. And we already talked about, and I'll try to keep this out and in kind of way when I'm talking about triple systems. So triples, as I said, are very common. So we have multiple planet systems, about 500 of the 1,300 exoplanet systems or confirmed ones are multiplanet systems. We know we have binary planets, both circumbinary planets and the circumstellar, the planet orbiting only one of the stars. We have moons, we know in the solar system. We haven't seen exomoons yet, but it's very likely that they exist. And we can even talk about smaller size planetary object. We have, in solar system, we have binary planetesimals. We have many binary asteroids. We have binary Kuiper Belt objects. Rehm told you about that. Pluto Charon is an example of a binary system. Actually, even more than one moon has many moons. And we know these are actually quite frequent in the solar system, with at least tens or 20s, a few tens of percent of these planetesimals being in binaries. And we can also talk about, when you think about planets, we usually talk about a star and a planet. But we know that probably most stellar systems are in binaries. This typical separation, this is the same major axis, this is the fraction. It depends, of course, on the type of the star. But for example, solar type stars, we have most of the systems have are binaries and about a few tens of AU separations, so binary stars. And you can see here the binary fraction as a function of the stellar mass. As you can see, the more massive the stars are, the binary fraction is higher. More than that, you can also see the multiplicity fraction, which means that you might have more than one companion. How many companions do you have for each star? So as you can see, for massive stars, the average number of companions is more than one. So actually, most of the massive stars are actually in probably triple systems. So triples are very frequent. But if you think about planets, and we see all these Kepler planets, since we know that most of them are in binaries, it's very lucky that the extremely high fraction of even Kepler planets are actually in binary star systems. And as mentioned, this is also a problem in terms of what you determine even the size of the planets. If you have more than one star, it can affect your characterization of the planets. So I just mentioned this, that about a large fraction of stars are actually in triple systems. We know that about 8% of all stellar systems are actually in triples. This is for FGK stars. This is known to be much higher, as I just showed you, for massive stars. But as I said, I'll try to focus mostly on planetary systems. So why is that more really interesting? So first of all, the first level of purely dynamically evolving systems is a triple system. And if just a binary on a Keplerian orbit, it just stays there all the time. Nothing happens. Of course, if you add dissipational processes, for example, tides, you can change. It can evolve in time. But if you're just talking about no dissipational processes, just purely kind of point masses, if you just have a binary, nothing changes. You need a third companion to make some evolution. So multiple systems are the first level where you have actually complexity in terms of the dynamics. And as I said, since most of the exoplanetary systems are in some sense triples, it's really important to understand not just for the triples themselves, but for even for higher multiplicity, we can think that the triples as being kind of the stepping stone to understand higher multiplicity systems. So triple systems might not be stable. Okay, I'll discuss a bit more. You might have, if they are too compact in some sense, there you have strong interaction between the components of the system, and one of the objects might be ejected or collide, or you have collision between the different objects in the system. This is what we have in, for example, multiple planets or multiple oligarchies in an evolving planetary system. At some point, they collide, for example, become unstable, they collide, they can form a more massive planet. And we can think about different timescales for the evolution of a triple system, both short timescale, this instability, and long-term secular evolution, something related to, for example, the lead of Kozai evolution that Scott was talking about. And I'll focus a lot about that because it's one of the most important processes, dynamical processes, for triple systems, which really affects the overall evolution of a planetary system, especially for example, potentially for this eccentric migration that Boaz just told you about. As I said, you have the dynamics of triple systems, which I'll discuss a bit more, but it can also be coupled to dissipative processes, for example, like Boaz just told you. For example, you have a third companion, which drives an inner binding into highly eccentric orbits. Once it's highly eccentric, you might have tidal processes, and then it would go through this eccentric migration. So we have kind of two stages. One is the extra companion induces this eccentric orbit, and then you have interesting coupled evolution. You can also have subcouplings of the simple pure dynamical evolution with some other aspects, non-Keplerian aspects. General relativity can play a role, oblateness of the star or a planet, or even the existence of inner binaries. Kind of think about not as a triple system, but a quadruple system, and an inner binary can also affect the evolution. So I've talked very generically, and now, and I just mentioned that you have this inner kind of processes, deceptive processes. These could be mergers, collisions. For example, you drive these hot Jupiters, this eccentric migration, up to its final configuration, it might actually even merge. And you can have, of course, the coupling with other processes, like gas drag. If you have a disk around and you have a triple system, you have all these can couple together, and all of these other aspects can affect it. And I'll talk about them one by one. Okay, just I'll jump over that. So let's try to look on what kind of triple system do we have. And I'll try to talk about kind of the level of activity that triple system can have in order to look from kind of the most hierarchical, very stable system to the least stable systems, which are most violent in a sense, or most interesting in terms of the interaction that you have. So maybe the most simple system you can have is, let's say, just a triple system. We have inner binary, a third companion, which is very far away. And if the whole system is also coplanar, not eccentric, more or less nothing interesting would happen. The inner binary would just revolve around itself in more or less Keplerian orbit. The third companion would also orbit the inner binary, also in more or less a Keplerian orbit. It would see the inner binary just as more or less one single mass. So you'd have just an inner binary and outer binaries, not really interacting. So that's one of kind of the most simple, not interesting cases. What about when you have an inclined system? So Scott told you about this lead of Kozai evolution. He showed you that in principle, when you have the outer companion, the perturbation, okay, the perturbers is at very high inclination, typically above 40 degrees. It also depends on eccentricity. But if it's a high inclination, then the third companion can induce, okay, oscillation, so-called the lead of Kozai oscillation, of the inner binaries. What kind of oscillations? So let's say we have a star. This is the perturber far away. And here we have an inner binary. It could be a planet and a moon. It could be, again, a binary system with a third stellar companion, two different things. And if you can think about this is the same, this is, let's say, the apocenter, this is kind of semi-major axis. This is the inclination between the outer orbit and the inner orbit. And in a sense, this is the ellipticity. So we start with the circular orbits. Due to Kozai lead of evolution, what we have is we have a conservation of the total angular momentum, but we have kind of an exchange, in a sense, between the eccentricity and inclination. And this leads to kind of oscillation that go like this. When you go to lower inclinations, okay, so it evolves to lower inclinations, but it becomes highly eccentric, okay? And then, of course, it goes, and then it goes back, okay? And then back and forth like this. So these are the kind of Kozai oscillation that people mention all the time. So you have two effects, right? One is that you have the change of, it's one effect, but you can see it in two ways. One is a change of inclination, one is a change of eccentricity. The eccentricity is really interesting in respect to having this interesting dissipative process, because at pericenter, when you're very eccentric, you're very close at pericenter, then dissipative processes between the two companions could be important. And then you can have additional, more complex evolution, not just dynamics. The other aspect is the inclination change, which is also interesting observationally, because it relates to something called the spin-orbit misalignment that I think Dave Charbonneau was talking about in terms of at least observationally, and I'll talk about it a bit more. How does it look like? In a sense, if you just follow only the blue line here, okay, this case is just the sun and the two asteroids orbiting each other. And they are inclined, so it again it's a triple system, but it's the same for any kind of triple system when you think about Lidov Kozai oscillation. So what you see is that you have the inclination and you have the eccentricity, and both of them evolve as kind of very regular oscillations, right? This is the linear time, this is just in log term, this is why it looks like that. And you can see that they are kind of correspond to each other, right? So low inclination, in this case, this is low inclination I'm talking, in this case it's a retrograde, so it's 140 is actually lower than it's kind of the other way around. In principle, the low inclination corresponds to high eccentricity and vice versa. And what you see is, of course, as was mentioned before, you don't have any exchange of energy, you don't change the same major axis, so the same major axis it stays the same all the time, only the inclination eccentricity changes through this oscillation. Yes? So I'll mention the quadrupole and octuple in a minute, okay? This is just a quadrupole order. Okay. So, as I said, they are hierarchical coplanar system in which nothing happened. And then you can talk about hierarchical inclined or eccentric triples, okay? And let's begin with hierarchical enough such that the orbital periods, okay? It's not exactly correct to just look on the periods, but you also need to look on eccentricity. But for first order, let's look just on periods. So if the ratio is high, you have just these simple Lidov Kozai oscillations. And you can actually have two types, in a sense. It's not actually two types, it's the same thing. But you have different levels of oscillations. I think the Scott showed you how to derive these Lidov Kozai oscillations up to so-called a quadrupole order. If you take higher orders, and sometimes you need to take, because when you when you're talking about eccentric binaries and you take about non-equal mass binaries, and especially if you're talking about high eccentricities, then these Lidov Kozai oscillations that I told you about, okay, these ones could be not as ordered. In a sense, you have another modulation at a longer time scale, okay. And in terms of technically, why do people actually do this secular analysis? I think Scott told you about orbital evolution in terms of simulations. N-body simulations are extremely expensive. So when you want to try to understand the long-term evolution of a triple system, for example, you need to try to do these simple assumptions and do this secular analysis, okay? Which is, again, up to, it depends on the assumption, but it could be extremely accurate and you can easily integrate it to a very long time scale. So, but when you use that, you do several different assumptions, and one of them is the way the order that you kind of derive when you do this Lidov Kozai calculation. And at the octuple order, what I showed you is something like that. And this is typically true when you have the angular momentum, for example, of the inner binary is very, very small compared to the angular momentum in the outer binary. In this case, Lidov Kozai oscillations are typically have this kind of regular shape. It could be a bit more complicated when you're talking about a mass ratio, which is not, the ratio between the angular momentum of the inner binary and the outer binary becomes comparable, okay, then you need to remember that in the whole system you have the conservation of the total angular momentum. So if you have the angular momentum of the outer orbit is much larger than the smaller ones, then the old ones can change eccentricity inclination very significantly, but the other orbits hardly does anything. But if they become comparable, you actually have exchange between them, and you can actually see much, much larger differences. And I'll just show you this. So in this case, you can actually have something which is very different. This is, this quadruple level lid of Kozai oscillation, very regular regular oscillations in inclinations and in eccentricity. This is 1 minus E, here. Okay. But when you actually take into account the higher order of this derivation, which are important, again, when in the appropriate conditions, then you can actually have very different kind of evolution, which, as you can see, have some kind of this strange long-term modulation. So each Kozai cycle here is just this short thing, but you have long-term evolution. And in this case, you actually can have extremely much more highly eccentric orbits than in the regular, the so-called quadruple level lid of Kozai oscillation. But these are just modes and technicalities. In a sense, lid of Kozai oscillation is just a secular evolution of triple system, which could lead to extremely high eccentricities in some cases. And you had this oscillation as its correspondence between inclination and eccentricities. The exact type of them is very important in the sense of what can happen. But in a sense, whether it's octopole or quadrupole is, in a sense, derivation. The gravity doesn't care really about whether you're octopole or quadrupole in the deep sense. Okay, that's what it's actually what you get, and you do care about what kind of things you can get out of it. Okay, so this was in kind of these highly hierarchical systems. Okay. If you can get it, you can get this secular evolution, and you can have so-called strong secular evolution, or something called eccentric lid of Kozai, in the case where the octopole level is important, and you can have much more eccentric evolution of the system, and you can also have this change of the relative inclinations become much more much more interesting, and I'll talk about it in a second. We can also talk about less hierarchical, in a case where the orbit of the outer orbit versus the inner orbit, okay, is the ratio is much smaller. In this case, one of the assumptions that you made with the new secular analysis start to fail to fail, because we always assume that we can just average out, okay, over the orbit of both the inner binary and the outer binary. But when the orbits, okay, the periods become more comparable, the change over one orbit. Okay, one inner orbit or one outer orbit can be significant or not negligible. Then you cannot assume this the orbit really exactly closes about itself. So you don't really have a fully secular evolution, and you need to take this into account. And this makes changes at this level. Okay, it seems very similar to this lid of Kozai oscillation, but effectively, when you especially see that when a pericentric approach, you can actually have a big jumps in how the pericentric approach changes. And I'll show a figure of that in a second. When you're becoming even closer in, even less hierarchical, then the system can become unstable completely. Okay? Until now, we're talking about orbits that did not cross each other. Okay? At some point, we can actually have, when you have unstable configuration, the orbits can start to cross each other, you can have collision, you can have ejections, you don't even, so now you have exchange of energy, which in the previous case, especially here, we talked about only exchange of angular momentum. Here, in the unstable configuration, we are really exchanging energy between the different components, and we can eject, for example, one of the systems. There are some interesting aspects when you talk about two planets. Okay, just give me a second. When you talk about two different planets, okay, this I gave you just in terms of periods, but of course the masses are important. The more massive you are, okay, the less stable the system is. So and you can actually have some interesting aspects when you have different two planet systems, okay, and they could have period ratio which are much smaller than that, okay, and still be stable. You have mean motion resonance. I think Yoram, we're going to talk about secular chaos. I won't going to talk about that. Yes, please.
What do you mean exactly by dynamical
time scale? Dynamical scale of the order of orbital period. Okay. Could be a few times, but this is not much longer than that. Okay, so as I mentioned, the coupling within this secular evolution, change of eccentricity and cation, can couple to dissipative processes like tidal friction. And then you can actually have interesting aspects, and many, many people talk about that. I just mentioned also Peter Egerton, because although Lieder and Kozai talk about this secular evolution already in the 60s, I think Egerton was one of the first to actually rekindle this aspect of Lieder-Kozai oscillations together with tidal friction. And so I just mentioned his name too, among many others, including Forst Zwie, who suggested the interaction begins already in the 70s. We actually have evidence for Lieder-Kozai. So we always talk about it theoretically, but we do care about what the observations, right? So in the first systems, we immediately can see Lieder-Kozai oscillations or their effects. For example, we look at the irregular moons of the giant planets, and we look on the inclinations distribution. What we see is interesting. We see both prograde and retrograde orbits. But more interesting thing is that we see nothing in between, nothing at high inclinations. One of the, at least the interpretation of this, is what happens is that when you have a star, the sun, Jupiter, let's say, and an irregular moon at very high inclination, okay, above 40, above 60 degrees, then this, it can go through Kozai-Lieder oscillation. It can become extremely eccentric. When it becomes extremely eccentric, two things can happen, okay? In the most extreme case, it can actually collide with the star, okay? It doesn't have to do that. If you have some moons in the inner regions, so-called regular moons, it can actually collide with one of these moons. In any case, it won't survive. It can also have, if it's farther out, when you become very eccentric, its upper center becomes very large and then become unstable, okay, because of the perturbation by the sun, and could also be ejected. So in any case, you're actually going to lose some of these moons because of Lieder-Kozai oscillations. As they become extremely eccentric, they just can collide or tidally interact with the planet in this case and be lost. And we see evidence for that in this case. How does this look like when you now combine exactly what Boaz told you about, but in the case he didn't know, he said there could be different processes that lead to eccentric orbit. What happens when you look on Kozai? So we can look on, let's say we have a star, a planet, and another star, okay, that induces Kozai oscillation. So we can see it can become extremely eccentric, in this case almost close, very close to one. Each time it comes to a pace center, which is very close to the star, it has the tidal dissipation become very important. And over the very long-term evolution, it starts to have dissipation. And you see this strange evolution. Now we go to gigaears, okay? This was kind of a short time. This was short time. This is long time. And you see that at some point, okay, it gets to the position where it just migrates, okay, in this way and becomes very close, like Boaz told you. So in this case, Lieder-Kozai oscillation lead you to this extremely high eccentricity, and then from then on, together with tidal dissipation, you actually migrate in and become potentially hot Jupiters, or might even collide with a star. And again, depends on the longer-term evolution. One other interesting aspect is that you have changes of inclination during this time. Okay, and as you can see, what happens here is that you, in the end, when you actually kind of become very circular, you also get to, in this case, inclination of about kind of close to 40 degrees, basically close to where you were when you were the most eccentric. And this was both suggested by Egerton, and later on, Fabike and Termain mentioned this is one of the ways all this this kind of evolution can produce very short period binaries. Okay, and not only that, it can maybe, it would produce some very specific inclination, okay, of the planet compared to its original orbit. So, let's say I started, we assume that we had originally a disk, right, where the planet was formed. And then we have another companion at very high inclination. And then, so this inner planet star goes through Lieder-Kozai oscillation, become eccentric, but it also changes its relative inclination relative to the outer orbit. Now, if the inner star doesn't, the inner star doesn't change its spin, okay, or spin direction. We'll talk about it. I mentioned aspect where it can do that, but if it doesn't, then it means that when you change the inclination of the inner binary, you also change, okay, the relative inclination, okay. So this is the orbit, and this is the original spin, okay. So this is the orbit, and you start having a spin orbit misalignment, because of this little causal situation, okay? You change the inner binary, but you maybe haven't changed the spin. In this case, you can actually have a different inclination, and you also have both, no, both different inclination between the outer and inner orbit, but you also have different inclination between the original spin and the orbit of the planet. So causal oscillation could produce a specific type of misalignment potentially between a star and the planet. I'm going to be, I think, the first to actually discuss this relative chain inclination, which can actually even lead to retrograde orbits. Okay? If you look in the total conservation of the total angular momentum, and you look on the angular momentum of the inner binary and that of the outer binary, if the angular momentum is extremely small, okay, of the inner binary compared to the outer binary, you typically get a very symmetric evolution, in the sense that if you look on initially prograde orbits or initially retrograde orbits, both of them go through Kozai lead of oscillation, go like that, but they never cross the 90 degrees. They never actually become prograde orbits, cannot become retrograde orbits. But when the angular momentum of the inner binary becomes larger, or especially if they become comparable, then you can actually, the outer orbit also change significantly its angular momentum, and the relative inclination could actually become retrograde. So that was, I think, first suggested by Soderhelm in 2006. Okay, I won't go into that too much, but very interestingly, this, so I told you that could happen in a case where you have the inner angular momentum and the outer angular momentum comparable, but when you talk about eccentric orbits and non-equal masses, then this octuple level, lead of causal oscillation, when you actually do the calculation, can even without this ratio of angular momentum which become comparable, can actually lead to a flip out of the from a prograde to a retrograde orbit. Okay, so Smadar Naoz, I think, was one of the main people to pursue this, and Boaz Katz here, and so you can actually see this here. Okay, this was the lead of causal oscillation to quadruple order, and this is the octuple order. You see that the regular quadruple order, you just get these regular oscillations, but now you can get even this flip of from prograde to retrograde, which means that in principle, if you're now going back to this spin orbit misalignment, if you just think about lead of Kozai, then you can always get some relative inclination, but it cannot become completely retrograde. In this case, you could actually get to much higher and really retrograde orbits. So this lead of Kozai situation can give you a spin orbit misalignment of even retrograde orbits. And as you saw, I think, in the observation, we actually do have evidence for many retrograde orbits. Whether lead of Kozai is responsible for that and not other processes, that's a different question. And I think Yoram will discuss it a bit more. But this is certainly one of the possible ways of getting a retrograde, okay, spin orbit misalignment. Just note here that even though we have very nice secular analysis, etc., if you just compare to n-body simulation, this is doesn't show orbit. But even here, you see that the n-body and the secular analysis is not exactly. So we still miss some aspect of it. I won't discuss it here, but these are interesting aspects that, you know, people in the audience can follow and try to understand why don't our simple and secular analysis doesn't capture the whole picture of n-body simulation of the real, in a sense, physics. Yes? So that's not coming from that, I think. Of course, in principle, if you go to arbitrary order, at some point you can get everything that you want, but no, I don't think this is the case. So many people actually looked on the spin orbit misalignment, and as I said, I think Fabric and Termain were the first to do actually population synthesis of this relative inclinations. This was, I think, between the relative outer and inner orbits. Also interesting about the specific relative inclination between the really the spin and the orbit. They did it in the quadruple level approximation, but in many cases you need to go to higher level approximation. When you go to octuple order, you see some changes in distribution, but you still see the kind of more or less these two peaks, typically at relative low inclinations when you go to very highly eccentric orbits, okay? So this happens at low inclinations, so most of the planets are captured, in a sense, in this high inclination. What do I mean by capture? At some point, okay, when you become this dissipative processes or tidal attraction become important, they could induce additional precession of the system. So Scott told you about, I think, about the J2 precession and about the precession because of the third companion. If you have two different processes that both of them can produce a precession, they could actually quench each other because they are not kind of, in a sense, coherent. So they can quench each other, and so you can start with a little quasi oscillations. And at some point, when these tidal interactions or the other processes become important, you can actually quench a little quasi, and it doesn't continue to do the same kind of inclination. And when you can, for example, stop it in the sense of freeze out the changes at some specific inclination. Later on, I think this is the most recent one is maybe by Anderson et al. They looked on not just the Lidov Kozai oscillation even to octuple level, but also accounted for the spin of the star, the oblateness, because we also can also have interaction between the spin of the star and the planet. So it could be more complex, and you have extra processes. Each one of them changes a bit the picture. It's also changed the kind of distribution that you have. So we have the observations, okay? But now we can relate them, of course, to the theory and see whether, first of all, we capture all the physical processes, but also we can kind of try to test different theoretical, different theories for the origin of the spin orbit misalignment according to what they predict. And these are kind of the most recent predictions when you try to take as much as possible into account, in a sense. And of course, there are many, many assumptions going to that. For example, the level of the level of tidal interaction that you have, the spin of the stars, many, many aspects. So it's difficult and could be very degenerate, which is one of the problems. Some aspects are not degenerate, but some others are. Okay, just mentioned briefly that, as I said, this was the little quasi hierarchical configuration. If you are at kind of more compact systems and it's not really completely secular, then you can have some strange evolution. So this is very similar to Lidov Kozai, as you saw before. In this case, this is not a planetary system. In this case, this is a massive black hole and two binary stars around it, but it's the same thing for scaling down of a P system. But you can have these very large jumps, okay, between different pericenter approaches between each time of the quasi cycle. It's not kind of this order thing as we had before. You can have this bit of different things. And doing this pericenter approach, you can have very large kicks, very large changes. And this can be extremely important for producing, for example, collision between stars. Because if you go slowly and change the consistency slowly, at some point you have some tidal interaction. As I said, tidal interaction, for example, can change the evolution, maybe even quench quasi. But if you now do these jumps and you never get into this tidal regime, you just jump from being very far to directly collide, this could have different outcomes. And Boaz here, for example, noted that this could be very important for the collision between white dwarfs that could lead to type 1a supernovae. So that's kind of, I went a bit far from exoplanet, but just mention it. What's more important is, I don't think that this was basically little or almost not studied or explored, this regime, in the case of exoplanetary systems. So this is another, I think, very interesting direction that people can take when talking about dynamics of triple systems in these regimes. And many of the systems could be in this regime. Okay, these are not a real case where you have these not very hierarchical system. As said, it's have a lot of implications for compact objects, which are also interesting, but are not part of the story here. Okay, so I went from the semi hierarchical to less and less hierarchical. Now I get to the level of stability. And a triple system can be unstable. And I think it was mentioned before, but so people derived what kind of ratio between orbits can you have and still have a stable triple system. By means stable, you don't have this, as I said, crossing orbit, you don't have ejections or collisions. And this was mostly done numerically, okay? So I think one of the most used one is the Marding and Arces. This is for triple stellar systems. They had derived a specific relation coming from n-body simulation or free-body simulation. I think that Rosemary Marding had a more recent interesting stability analysis using resonant overlap. So this is more interesting, more analytic, not just coming from n-body simulation. I won't go into that. So this was for triple stars. You can derive a very similar thing for two planet systems. And again, this was mostly done numerically. There was one analytic derivation, typically usually people mention Gladman is the one who first suggested when you look on a coplanar system. Okay, you have a star, a planet, and another coplanar planet. Then you can derive analytically what's the closest separation that they can have and still be stable. Again, when you talk about the more general aspect, when you have eccentric orbits, when you have some inclined orbits, then there's no analytic yet, no analytic calculation, but there are results from a few body simulations. And again, it's interesting, I think, to actually understand it in the most basic level and not just use a few body simulations. Okay, very good. So, sorry for.
We had some discussion whether that should be one field or two segments.
Ah, okay, that's good. I think he did that. I think Cristobal Petrovic, I think, derived it from his simulation. I'll maybe focus that on an interesting thing that we're working on right now. So, that's as an interesting example. People talk a lot about the heat radius. Okay. So usually you talk about it about in respect to these plant formation aspects and the velocities. You can talk about the simplest mode of heat stability and say, okay, you have, let's say, a planet and you have some massless particle or just a moon around it. You can say, okay, how far can you put the moon and still be stable? And this was discussed a lot, okay? And I think in the last decades, people derived it and they found that they have prograde orbits are about two times less stable, prograde orbits are less stable than retrograde orbits. So retrograde orbits can have about two times as far relative to prograde orbits and still be stable. This is mostly because, and you think about how do you derive it, in a sense, you think about the relative acceleration that you get from the third companion, okay? This tidal acceleration from the third companion compared to the acceleration by the inner binary. And of course, then you actually care about the direction of the inner binary orbit, okay? If it's one prograde or retrograde, it could affect in the sense of Coriolis force, where we need to take into account the Coriolis force, and it can actually either help you or harm you in the sense of stability. So this was done in many times since the 70s. As far as I know, the only one who actually tried to look for not just for prograde completely or prograde zero inclination and retrograde 180 degrees, the only one I think who tried to do it analytically was Inanen in the 1980s. And he actually used the same kind of analysis of to calculate the heat radius, but now he actually looked on for arbitrary inclination. And what he found is something of this sort. Okay. By the way, this is just an interesting, this is a work led by my student, Evgeny Grishin, who's in the audience here. So this is what we see here. But if you actually do the simulation, the n-body simulation, put, let's say, an asteroid, a point mass around it, and the sun, and actually calculate to what extent, okay, you do many, many simulations of different separations and different phases, for example, and you can say, okay, to which point it's still stable. So everything which is blue here is unstable, the red here are unstable. And what you see is an interesting thing. First, you start seeing something which is very good, very consistent with the theory, here and maybe here, okay, in the end. But then you have this kind of strange thing here. And that was very interesting when I first read about it. One of the things that you see is that it starts happening at this high inclination. So one of the first thing I thought about is that this could actually come from lead of Kozai oscillations. Because when you derive this, you just use the separation of the asteroids from a sun, a planet, and a moon. So the separation of the moon from the planet. But if it's eccentric, it's apocentric, it's larger separation. So its effective separation could be larger. So what happens when you don't have Kozai? Okay, you start with a circular orbit. You are always on a circular orbit. And fine, the theory is fine. What happens when you start having Kozai? Then it could become very eccentric. When you become eccentric, when you're in this point in terms of the circular orbit, effectively you oscillate, right? Your eccentricity can become high and inclination low and the other way around. So you oscillate on this kind of diagonal line. So if you are here, you effectively cross this unstable line at some point. So even if you're here, you think you're stable, it could become actually unstable. And this could actually potentially explain this. So if we can try and put the effective Kozai, instead of putting the circular orbit separation, we talked just the actual separation, the apocenter separation, A times 1 plus E, when accounting for the maximal eccentricity that you get from Kozai. Then you get something which is taking this, but adding this Kozai, something which now is qualitatively much more similar to what we have here. So now we understand, indeed, why do we have this gap. Why doesn't it capture it? Oh, well, we took this maximal eccentricity, but effectively it doesn't spend a lot of time in this maximal eccentricity. So you might actually want to look on the average eccentricity, not the maximal eccentricity. If you do that, you get something which is a bit better. And you still have a problem in terms of inclination. Instead of starting at 40 degrees, as I told you, the field of Kozai usually starts, it actually begins at about 60 degrees or so, and it ends a bit further away. I won't talk about that. We think that this is related to another process called the evection, but which can, when you include it, you can get something better. We still miss something here, but I just want to show you an example of this stability analysis, looking at these different processes. Again, this is just kind of the basic understanding of Hill radius. Then you include Kozai, average Kozai, and you get an evection can help you a bit more. Okay. Now we went all over through the most hierarchical stable systems, okay? And we look on the secular evolution of these kind of triple systems, and we went up to the unstable ones. One interesting thing is that what can change the activity level? Because, for example, let's say you start with a stable triple, but something affects triple, changes its orbital parameter, so it becomes active. When it becomes active, again, all these processes become interesting. You can have these merger, collision, tidal interaction, etc., when activity is more important. So how can you do that? Well, you can take different examples. This is just an example. You can take a binary star or a planet and a star, and you can add a third companion to this binary. Okay. So before that, it was just inactive because it wasn't even a triple. Then you add the third companion, especially if it's high inclination, it can actually start, this whole system can start evolve through this secular evolution. How can that happen? I won't go into that much, but in principle, when you have in clusters, stellar clusters disperses, okay, sometimes some of the stars in the system can go more or less in the same direction with more or less the same velocity and can become bound. A different way of looking at that, in any stellar clusters, you always have these so-called soft binaries, which are produced and destroyed, somewhat related to this L3 mechanism that Rem mentioned for Kuiper belt binaries, and you form them, and then you destroy them. But if you form them, and then the cluster disperses, then they can actually still keep them, and you can form very wide binaries, in a sense, a star that captured another star. So in the same way, a binary can capture a third companion, and you know, something which was inactive can become active in that sense. Another way is looking on stellar evolution. I don't think anyone actually discussed stellar evolution, but it's also really, really important for planetary systems. And you can think about how stellar evolution changes the dynamics of systems. And we're talking about about the triple system, it can actually make very interesting changes. Let's give you just one example. How much time do I have?
You need to finish up.
I need to finish up. Okay. So I'll just give this one example and summarize by that. So let's say we have a binary, okay? And what we know when you have before, okay, we have a just regular binary. Now we have a stellar evolution and you lose the sum of the mass. Scott told you when you lose your mass adiabatically, okay, you can actually keep your eccentricity and you just keep a ratio between the initial separation to the final separation, the initial separation is just the ratio between the initial separation to the initial mass to the final mass. Okay, so the more mass you lose, the wider the binary becomes. This is when you talk about the binary system. When you talk about the triple systems, okay, now you have this inner binary which evolves, okay, because of mass loss, and you have the third companion which also evolves. Now the inner binary, in a sense, sees only the mass of the binary. So the relative mass loss is larger than the relative mass loss that the third companion sees because it contains all the third stars. So the inner binary separation becomes larger compared to the outer separation. So this means the period ratio changes. So you can start with a stable system and then go into unstable system. For example, you can start with a stable system, become unstable, completely unstable, and start to collide and merge. So mass loss in these kind of triple systems can give you changes in activity level of triples. I'll close with that and just summarize by saying that triples are extremely important. You know, people think of sometimes of triples as exotic. As said, for planetary systems, triples are all over the place. They are stepping stones for a higher multiplicity dynamics, And as I said, most systems do have these triples in some configuration. Most of them are actually active to some level. Even, and if they're not active now, they were active in the past, and this activity actually led to ejections, collision, etc. So when you try to understand exoplanetary systems, or even the solar system itself, you need to understand the second evolution of these kind of systems, and the different kind of scales and time scales which are involved, and how they can affect the evolution of the system, both through dynamics and their coupling to a dissipative physical process. Thank you. I know it's the end of the day, but just for out of respect, please ask me a question. Yes.
So we know that Kozai requires a minimum inclination to start working. So you probably said, and I just didn't catch it, but what are other mechanisms to pump up the eccentricity of, say, giant planets to start the high eccentricity migration?
Okay, so right, you have a catch 22. Okay, you start with, let's say, coplanar system. I want you to have, you know, Kozai, the change in inclination, okay, for example, but it only starts at 40 degrees. So yes, people usually discuss two different things. Either you have planet-planet scattering, for example, that can change, you have a change in inclination and eccentricities, or you could actually have another binary companion. I told you, actually, large fraction of any of these exoplanet systems have a third companion, and the inclination of the binary companions compared to this inner exoplanet system, they don't have to be aligned. So you could actually have potentially a relative inclination. Under what kind of condition can you still have from the exoplanetary system to begin with? That's a different question. Many people explore this possibility.
You mentioned two specific things that have already come up in the school and elsewhere, the Lidov Kozai and evection. Do you think that there are other really important examples, that is, specific things that that people would give a name to that come up in triple systems that haven't been found yet? Or is it just that they're so complicated that you have to look at them case by case?
Well, naming is, of course, always difficult questions, okay, about names and what you consider as important enough for naming. I think one...
Well, importance is based on how common.
Yes.
Both of those, one suspects, are actually fairly common.
Yes, I agree. So I think that, I think that coupling of these long-term secular processes and understanding how the relation, for example, to short-term processes, for example, mean motion resonance or evection with lead of Kozai, these coupling together could actually produce some very interesting aspects. So each one of them is kind of component by itself, but the coupling is actually extremely important and could actually change the picture of how these processes really evolve. And other than that, well, three-body problem was studied for a few hundred years, but I think one of the most interesting thing is that, yes, about things happened in the last 20, 10, 5 years, which actually change the picture. People do understand more about these triple systems. So do I believe? Yes. Can I point one on specifically? If I do, I immediately write the paper, of course. In a sense, much of the dynamics is well understood, okay? But I think there are still many missing things. I just showed you even one case where even our secular analysis doesn't catch all the n-body. And I think, but still, the n-body behaves very nicely, which means that we probably can understand it very nicely, okay? So we still don't catch everything. Even this quasi-secular regime hardly explored. I think it has potentially has huge implications. People just look on little Kozai because they can, but you need to look on the next step. So yes and no. Yes, I think it's going to be. No, I don't know which one.
Okay, let's thank Hagai again.